Great. Good morning, everyone. Can you hear me at the back? Am I audible at the back of the class? Okay, can somebody from the back please respond?
Yes,
sir.
Okay, thanks. All right, so good morning, everyone, and welcome to EE5311 Digital IC Design. So, hopefully, this is the class for which you intended to come. So, if not, then this would be a good time to leave. What this course is, as you all know, it's a primarily targeted at sort of the first year graduate level. It is a course on digital integrated circuit design. Okay, we'll take up each of those parts of the title and sort of analyze what exactly it means. What is it that we intend to cover in this course? Okay, and also look at what you can sort of expect to learn as part of the course itself. Okay. So as you can see, it is a pretty big class. It's a mix of first year M.Tech students, fourth year dual degree students, I believe fourth year B.Tech students also, and MS PhD. It's a pretty wide mix of students, okay? But the target audience is the first year graduate. Fourth year dual degree are considered at the same level at this point, okay? So either senior, final year undergraduate or first year graduate is what the target is over here. The assumptions, of course, are that, you know, you have already done courses on basic digital circuits, probably have done something on MOS transistor theory, okay? And what we will be covering in this course will be how you put those together and actually design parts of integrated circuits, okay? So, in case you're coming in late to class, please do not wait at the door, just walk in. Set it up at any point, right? So what we are going to do is, what I'm going to do right now is sort of go through the initial part of the, and go through the title, right? What exactly are the things that are covered in this course? Let's start by looking at the various parts of the title. First of all, what do we mean when we talk about integrated circuits? Okay, so let's start with that. What is your understanding of integrated circuits? What do we mean when we talk about integrated circuits? Can you give an example of an integrated circuit that you are familiar with? Yes, please. Operational amplifier, right? So the op-amp is probably the first IC that you get familiar with when you are doing an electronics course, right? So what does an op-amp do? Essentially, the idea of an op-amp is that it is a specifically constructed circuit which can amplify signals, right? It has certain properties. It essentially tries and generates a very high gain across a differential input, okay? And using that particular structure, you can then create various kinds of highly linear or highly optimized amplifiers for different kinds of conditions. You can construct amplifiers, you can construct filters, right? Various other kinds of things that can be built using the op-amp. Okay, so the op-amp was probably the first major circuit that made integrated circuits useful, right? But what makes it an integrated circuit? Why we call it an integrated circuit is because there are a number of different transistors that have all been integrated onto a single silicon die. Okay, so that's the core idea behind integration. So the idea of integrated circuit started off with this, but then sort of rapidly moved on to various other things. And eventually at some point people started looking at digital integrated circuits, right? So it sort of makes sense for us to look a little bit into what exactly do we mean by a digital integrated circuit. So what's a digital circuit to start with? Or a digital system? What do we have in mind when we talk about a digital circuit? Can you give some examples of digital circuits that you know of? Right? The core idea over there is a digital circuit. The word digital itself means sort of it is an extension of discrete, right? There are a number of fixed digits or discrete states that the system operates in. Okay? So usually these things are built around the concept of binary valued logic. Okay? Which is also known by the term Boolean logic. Right? So why logic? Because originally the whole idea of this, the Boolean algebra or the Boolean logic, was created for sort of understanding how people think. How is it that you take statements that are either true or false and compose them in order to create new statements? Okay? So if you go back and look at the original work by George Boole way back in the 19th century, that was supposed to be on the laws of thought. How do people think? How do you take different statements that are true or false and infer new results regarding them? Okay, if I take two statements that are true and I combine them and say this and this, then is the result also true? If two statements are, or rather if I have two statements, one is true and the other is false, and I combine them in with an and, then what happens to the result? Is the result true or is it false? How can I make statements in such a way, right? That is how it originated, which is why it is called the study of logic, right? And because it was originally, the work was done by George Boole, it's called Boolean logic, right? It's also called binary valued logic, simply because we are talking about a logic system, a way of understanding these kind of statements, which considers only two truth values, either true or false. Okay. So in our case, we are going to be considering digital circuits which are specifically this binary valued logic. Right? There are other kinds of digital systems. You could have ternary systems, you could have other systems which have multiple states. But for the purpose of this course, we are going to be concentrating on binary valued logic. Okay. Now, how are digital systems? How can you build digital systems? What do they consist of? Right? Typically, digital systems are composed of various kinds of operations, right? You start out with some kind of a functionality, right? Which would be a set of Boolean equations or some statements expressed using Boolean algebra. And we implement them using two kinds of logic structures, right? The major kinds of logic structures, one are what are called combinational gates or combinational logic. Another is sequential. The idea of combinational gates is something like the AND structure that I talked about earlier, right? I have two truth values, or rather two variables which can take on different truth values. I want to combine them and find out what is the result of this and that, okay? And I get a new result which is a combination of both of these. Or I have two statements and I want the OR of those, or I want an exclusive OR, I want to invert a statement, right? All of those things are individual combinational logic pieces, right? Most of Boolean algebra essentially deals with how do you compose these kinds of logic structures, right? How do I modify statements that are written in certain, modify certain algebraic statements that have been written using these logic structures? How do I improve the number of such statements that I need? How do I make it more compact? How do I show that one is equivalent to another, all of those things are what Boolean algebra deals with. By itself, it is not sufficient to implement all kinds of different computational functionalities, right? For that, we need an additional kind of structure, the sequential gates, right? Essentially, this introduces the concept of state. Just give me a moment. Or there is the concept of state or memory that needs to be introduced into the system, okay? And this state is essentially some way of saying, okay, as I'm doing some computation or doing some work with the system, I need to remember what I was doing last and use that information in order to go forward and do further computations, okay? The most basic way in which this is used is in the concept of so-called finite state machines. Okay, so the finite state machine essentially says, I have some way by which I can store the present state of a system as a set of binary logic values, right? A set of zeros and ones. Okay, now with the by combining the present state of the system with other inputs that are coming to the system, in some way using some kind of combinational logic, I can generate a new state for the system. Okay? And in such a way, this entire system can evolve with time. It can keep on changing as time goes on. Right? If I generalize this approach and I sort of say, okay, I have a finite state machine, but even the states which it can occupy, I'm going to make them programmable by essentially allowing it to have a larger amount of memory, increase the number of states that are possible for the system, and allow it to sort of explore different states. I can essentially get this to a point where any arbitrary type of computation, what do I mean by computation? It could be something as simple as adding two numbers. It could be deciding whether a particular traffic light should turn red or green at a given time. It could be deciding when the alarm on your watch is supposed to go off. Right? Any such kind of a computation or a decision can be emulated by such a system. Okay? So eventually the finite state machines can be extended to the implementation of complete computing systems. Okay? So that is sort of the final goal of the digital integrated circuit. You start off with something which just talks about, okay, I have basic binary logic, binary values. I want to combine them with an AND gate or an OR gate, or just invert one of them. But then I start composing more of them together and I create a slightly more complex logic. Right? I put even more of those modules together, I create a finite state machine with some logic of its own. I increase the complexity of that finite state machine, eventually I end up with a programmable state machine, a programmable computer. Okay, and that in some sense is capable of doing any kind of computation that you need. Okay, so that is sort of where digital systems come into the picture. They start off with very basic logic structures, but in principle, in theory at least, they are capable of doing any computation that you can put down mathematically with a certain degree of accuracy. Okay, so as far as we are concerned, this is the thing. We have combinational logic, we have sequential logic. We know that any kind of digital integrated circuit has to be constructed as a combination of these kinds of logic gates. Right? This course, the third part of the title, design, right, talks about how do you actually build those gates. Okay, so while talking about design, it makes sense to talk about the counterpart of design. So there are usually two parts to any engineering, right? There is the first part which is analysis, and there is the second part which is design, right? So whenever you are given any structure or anything new, the first thing you need to do is understand it, understand how it works, understand what it does. That part is analysis. Okay. So a lot of what we will do to start with in the course will in fact be analysis. We will start off by taking something where I tell you, okay, this is how a particular gate is designed, right? And we say, okay, how does it work? This is what is actually happening with it. This is why it behaves in a certain manner, and therefore this is why it realizes the functionality that we expected of it. That's the analysis part, right? Analysis is not necessarily easy, but it is a bit more straightforward, but because it is better structured. You know that there are certain techniques you can use in order to understand how something works. Design is the second part, right? Where you say, okay, now give me something that will get me this functionality. And that is typically a much harder problem, if not for any other reason than for the fact that there are multiple ways of doing anything. Okay, any kind of functionality that you want, there are typically more than one way of getting the same result, right? So because of that, design in general is a much harder problem than analysis. As far as this course goes, we are not going to go deep into designing very large systems. We are going to be designing at a fairly small scale, but still there will be enough aspects of design that you will need to sort of use your judgment and say, okay, you know, I have multiple ways of doing this. Now I need to make a choice and justify that choice. At any point you should be able to say, okay, this is what I have chosen and this is why I have chosen it. Okay? That is the most important part of design. You should always be able to justify why you have chosen something. The justification might be at the end of the day, okay, look, these three are equivalent, I could pick any one of them without making any real difference to the result, so I picked one. But you should be able to sort of say that these are equivalent. If somebody else can show that something was better, it means that your design was not as good as it could have been. Okay? So design is the process of actually building something new from smaller parts. Okay? As far as this particular course is concerned, we are going to be talking about the design of digital integrated circuits. Okay? But having said that, I now need to go into a little bit more detail on what part of the digital integrated circuit are we going to look at as far as this course is concerned. Okay? Because that topic, design of digital integrated circuits, is huge. It will probably take like multiple courses in order to cover that to a reasonable extent. What we are going to do in this course is one part of it. Okay? Which part? We'll sort of look at that a little bit more as we go further. Okay? So the main part that happens in design is, right, or rather design or implementation, we are basically talking about the physical realization or implementation of the logic structures that we have so far derived at an equation level, right, at an algebraic level, right. So what's an example? Supposing I say that, you know, I want to implement something which is the AND of two particular truth values, right? One way by which we can think about it, right, and which is in fact used in order to illustrate the basic principles of digital circuits, is to think in terms of switches, right? So the way that we say it is, supposing I have a voltage source here and I have a bulb that needs to blow over here. I have two signals A and B, and I want the bulb to glow only when both A and B are on or active in some way. Okay? So what would that mean? If I was to think of A and B as controlling some switches, then how should those switches be connected? In series, right? So what I am saying is, I have one switch controlled by A, another switch controlled by B, and both are connected in series like this. What this means is only when A is active, that is that switch is closed, and B is active, will the bulb glow. Okay, if any one of them is not active, the bulb will not glow. Okay. So this is the AND function, right? If I wanted OR, then what would I do? I would put the two switches in parallel. So in this way you can sort of see how the notion of a switch, something that can be controlled, can be used in order to actually get a physical realization of the logic gates or the logic functionality that we already know about. Okay. Now what we are going to do is to say, okay, now what I want is some kind of a switch that can be controlled by means of an electrical signal, right? What would that be? Can you think of any kind of a circuit element that acts like a switch which can be controlled by an electrical signal? So there may be multiple things, but what we are going to use over here is a transistor, right? So the transistor in particular, the MOS field effect transistor, is what we are going to use as the core element for implementing all of this functionality that we want. We are going to use a transistor as a switch. Okay. This is the basic symbol for a transistor. These are the two terminals that it is connecting together, and this is the control terminal. So when I apply a voltage to the control terminal, I can decide whether or not the other two terminals are connected together or not. Okay. So that is the core idea of what I am going to do with a transistor. Right. So what we will be seeing in the next few classes is, how do I use a transistor in order to implement a switch? But then comes the real world, right? Ideally, I would like this transistor to be a perfect switch. What does a perfect switch behave like? What are the things that I expect from a perfect switch? How much current should it be able to pass? There should be no limit, right? So an ideal switch should be able to pass infinite current. How much current do I expect to see coming out of that control terminal? Zero. The control terminal should not see any current coming out of it at all. It's only used in order to decide whether or not the switch is on or off, right? How fast do I expect it to sort of switch on or off? Instantaneously, right? As soon as I decide that, okay, the switch should be on, it should turn on, and immediately the two sides should be connected. As soon as I decide it should be off, I break the connection. Okay? So instantaneous switching. Now this is an ideal switch. The obvious reason why I am putting down all these conditions is because in reality none of them can be realized, right? So that's the problem, right? That's, otherwise there was nothing further to study in this course, right? We already know how switches can be used in order to implement logic structures. The problem is the switches that we have are not ideal. Okay, the switches that we know of and are planning to use as far as this course is concerned are the MOS transistors. They have problems. They cannot pass an infinite current. There is some amount of current that passes through from the gate also into the other terminals. There is a certain resistance and capacitance associated with each of those terminals, because of which they cannot switch instantaneously. There are a number of issues that we need to look at and figure out how to work around them. Okay, so because of all these issues, it turns out that a real gate, logic gate, is only an approximation to the ideal logic circuit that you would like to see. Okay, in the ideal world, a digital circuit would see only 0 and 1. In the real world, it actually sees a voltage, right? And that voltage takes a certain amount of time to go from 0 up to the supply voltage or to fall back to 0. Okay, so all of those kind of issues also need to be taken care of in when you are actually building the circuits. And that is what we are going to sort of look at as we go forward in the discussion of how to build combinational logic structures, right? And eventually also sequential logic structures. Okay, so let's take a slight digression now and look at the overall process by which a large scale digital circuit would be designed. Okay, so this is a so called design process. Let's say that you have got an idea for the latest processor to go into a mobile phone. Okay, so nowadays you keep hearing every day there's a new kind of phone that's been announced by someone. They start off with dual core, quad core, octa core, I don't know where they want to stop, right? After that they'll start saying, okay, it's not just that it has 8 cores, it also has something else which is capable of doing something, you know, it can figure out your movement, it can calculate the amount of calories that you have consumed, it can wake you up at the correct time, it can buy bread and stock your fridge for you, whatever it is, right? All kinds of features they keep adding to that. So how do you go about designing a system like that, right? The first thing that needs to happen is a specification. So when someone wants to design a system, let's say it's either a mobile phone processor or it's something like a stopwatch. Okay, a stopwatch is much easier to understand because the parts that we are dealing with, we can actually just put them all down clearly over here. What are the kinds of functionalities that you need from a stopwatch? It should take some input from a button. Every time I press the button, something should start counting. When I press the button again, it should stop and it should show me a result on the display. How much is the time that elapsed? Some other button maybe will reset it and allow me to start again. Okay, that's the basic functionality of a stopwatch. So somebody writes out specifications saying, okay, there are two buttons. The first button is used in order to start the stopwatch. The second button is used in order to stop it. Or rather, the first button when it pressed again will be used in order to stop it. The second button is used in order to reset it. Okay, so that's a specification. Somebody has already given me a system level specification. There are two buttons, there is a certain resolution, so many microseconds or so many milliseconds that I want to count. There's again a specification on the display. There are so many digits that I want. Okay, so for example, for a stopwatch, the number of buttons, display resolution, the whatever minimum time step, right? Couple of other things like this you could probably think up of, right? What are the requirements of that stopwatch, right? So somebody just explains this to you. This specification is probably done in English, or it could be done slightly better by sort of saying, okay, I will write a program which will give you the exact functionality of the stopwatch. Okay, so I write a program, let's say in MATLAB or in C or some language like that, which emulates a stopwatch. Right? So now you know, okay, I have these inputs, I have this kind of behavior, this is how it's supposed to behave. So now somebody looking at that program or using that program knows exactly what you want. There are no further questions. Right? Nothing is left unclear. Right? But there might be a process of refinement. This is part of the specification process. Somebody might come and ask, okay, you said that you want this kind of so many milliseconds of resolution, right? Is it sufficient instead if we provide you with this, right? Or as far as the display is concerned, do you really want to have so many digits shown on the screen? Or how many seconds maximum do you want to be able to count, right? What is the battery life that you are expecting? A few further refinements that can be added on to this. Okay. Once you have refined it in that sense, you would also have things like, for example, let's say it's not a stopwatch, it's something slightly more complex. You might have some kind of numerical data to be represented, some numbers, how many bits are to be used for the numbers, how are those numbers supposed to be computed, what are the operations you need to do with those, right? So sort of numerical representation, flow of the data and so on need to be refined over here. Okay. After you have done all this, you already know how digital systems can be built, or at least the digital circuits course has taught you a little bit about how to make finite state machines, how to design finite state machines, how to implement them using logic gates and sequential gates. So you can sort of start putting together building blocks. I know how to create an adder. I know how to create a multiplier. I know how to create a shift register. I know how to create a comparator. Right? So those are the modules. Right? The large scale modules that you already know, okay. Adder, I just say, okay, I give it two numbers, it'll add them and give me the result. I'm not saying anything in terms of how it is to be built. Okay, right now I'm just saying I need an adder. As far as the stopwatch is concerned, I can say, okay, I need an adder and some other pulse which tells me when to add one to that adder. Okay, a counter, so to say, which keeps on counting, incrementing by one. Okay, at what rate does it increment? At whatever is your required time step. So the module level design can be done by a person who already knows the specification. Even for a large scale system like a full blown processor, the way that you would go about module level design is, I need this kind of an ALU, the arithmetic and logic unit needs to be able to do these operations. I need so much memory as cache memory, right? I need to be able to access the memory using this wide a bus. I need my program counter to be so many bits wide. I need so many registers in my system. All of that can be designed at the module level. Right? I'm not talking about gates at all so far. It's only modules. The next question is, how do I refine those and say, okay, I know I need an adder. How should I implement an adder? Okay? So how does an adder get built out of gates? Essentially says, go from the module level down to the gate level design. Okay. Now the combination of these module level and gate level design is sometimes a particular variant of those is what is used as, is what is referred to sometimes as register transfer logic or register transfer level, right? RTL. It's a combination of module level design and gate level design. It's essentially telling you that I can think in terms of modules, a register as a complete module to be implemented, and certain functionalities that need to happen. How do I update the values of those registers in order to implement the final function that I want? Okay. module level design is saying, okay, I will deal with it at that level of abstraction. Gate level is saying, okay, I will tell you exactly how to make an adder or how to make a register using individual gates. Right? But these are still gates. They are at the level of AND gates, OR gates, XOR gates, inverters, and so on. Okay? The next stage beyond gate level design is transistor level design. Okay? Where I take individual gates and I say, okay, you want a OR gate? This is how you can create an OR gate using the transistors that are available to you. These will be the properties of the OR gate. This will be how much area it consumes. This will be the amount of delay that you get when you apply an input and try to look at the output. Okay. This is the amount of power that it will consume when it switches values from 0 to 1 or 1 to 0. Those are the specifications at the level of the transistor. Okay. And finally, once I have the transistor level design, I need to go even one step further below this and say, okay, how do I build a transistor? I need to actually create patterns on the silicon substrate, right? So that's the actual layout. This is a silicon level patterning. Right? Which tells you exactly how to draw structures which will behave in a certain way. Right? And which also tells you, once you have those structures, once you have created those, how will you actually manufacture this whole setup, right? How do I create something which takes the silicon die, draws all these things on it, you know, gets the kind of behavior that I expect from it, okay? Now, this course, we will start off mostly at the transistor level. Okay. From there, using transistors in order to create individual gates and going up to gate level design. How do I assemble multiple gates together? To some extent to module level design, but not really to a large extent. We will be stopping at the point where we say, okay, this is how I can create certain kinds of modules using the gates or transistors that I know about. But not really about how do I go further up the chain and say, okay, how do I assemble these modules together in order to create a large system. That part is, if possible, we will touch upon some part of it in a later part of the course, but it is not the major focus of this particular course. Okay. As far as going down the hierarchy is concerned, layout, we will touch upon. We will look at some parts of the layout. For example, how do you do the layout of certain kinds of gates? How do I construct the layout of so that these transistors will behave in a certain manner? Okay, but the details of how do I go down that chain, how do I actually use that layout in order to create the masks, create the patterns, actually do the chemical processes, no, all of that is out of the scope of this particular course. There's a VLSI technology course which covers much more of that in detail. Okay. So this is primarily where we are going to be focused for the most part of this course. How do I do some amount of layout in order to get transistors to behave in a certain way? What is my focus? How do I get those transistors to behave like certain kinds of gates? From there, how do I use those gates in order to build certain types of modules? And very briefly about how do I use those modules in order to build larger systems? Okay. So this is where the focus of this course is going to be. So, as far as the scope of the course is concerned, right, there are certain things which you know, just to sort of set the expectations right at the beginning. For the most part, we are going to be focusing on the so-called 180 nanometer technology node, right? 180 nanometer means that the minimum feature size which is used in order to create a transistor or to create a wire or whatever it is, the minimum size of a element in this technology is 180 nanometers or 0.18 microns, right? This is a fairly old technology, right? Probably 10 or more years old, okay? The reason why we still use this is because the fundamental principles have not changed, right? The core idea of how does a transistor behave, how do I use transistors in order to create certain kinds of circuits, has not changed since 180 nanometer technology, or not changed significantly. There have been changes. There are things which you need to worry about at the current generation. So what is the latest generation of technology that you are familiar with? 22? Anything else? So I think Intel is now manufacturing at 14, right? IBM is also manufacturing at 14. So there are some of the top end processors, for example, are already being manufactured at 14 nanometers, right? Or at least in large scale tests. They will be in sort of public production probably in another few months or a year, right? So this is like almost an order of magnitude away, right? 180 nanometers. It's like 10 times the size. Clearly there are changes, there are differences in terms of how the transistors behave, some of the properties change, some of the things that you need to worry about at the higher technologies either may or may not be issues at the lower technologies, okay? But the core principles more or less remain the same. So we are going to focus on 180 nanometers because it is sort of easier to explain things at that level, and we also have access to models more readily at those levels. Okay, where necessary we will bring in some concepts of what are the other things that need to be understood at the different, at the lower technologies or more advanced nodes. Okay, we will almost exclusively be focusing on MOS, so the metal oxide semiconductor transistors, and how you use those in order to create digital ICs. This is once again not the only way of doing things, right? You would have heard of TTL, the transistor-transistor logic, which is based on BJTs. There are various other things also based on BJTs. There are other kinds of field effect transistors. Now there are other things based on carbon nanotubes and various other kinds of things which are also largely at an experimental level, right? This is the most common. By far as industrial production at this point in time is concerned, MOS is easily pretty much 99.9% of all digital circuits you could say are built on MOS, right? Some form of MOS technology, mostly CMOS, static CMOS. If not static CMOS, then some close variant of that, okay? That does not mean that the others are not important. We will touch upon some of the other developments, but once again, like I said, the purpose of this course is to give you core ideas. Further developments, it is up to you. You can always learn about them once you have the core concepts clear, okay? So certain things, for example, like FinFETs and carbon nanotubes, TTL logic, all of that are out of scope of this course, right? We will touch upon them where possible, but not go into them in any significant amount of detail, okay? And okay, so that's basically it as far as the scope of the course is concerned. Now a little bit about the structure. You know that there are 4 lecture hours per week, right? So it is Monday 10, Tuesday 9, Wednesday 8, and Friday at 12, I believe, right? Yeah. So these are the timings of the class. In general, all 4 lectures will be used. Certain weeks, one of the lectures will be replaced by either a tutorial or a demonstration session, right? But you are still expected to attend all of those. Okay, this is a sort of 4 credit course by the older method of calculation. I'm not sure of how much it is in the new method, but whatever. It's a 4-hour per week course. Okay? There will be assignments. these will be based on, there will be some assignments which are just hand calculations, you will essentially need to work them out. They will be more sort of tutorial in nature, just to sort of get you used to the idea of, or rather to give you some practice with the kinds of design that we are doing. But the more important assignments are typically going to be based on SPICE, which is a simulation package, a simulation software which hopefully all of you have at least heard of, if not used. Okay, anyone here who has not used SPICE before? Okay, so there are a fair number of people who have not used SPICE. We will have a demonstration session on SPICE. SPICE is a very important tool for understanding how these kind of circuits can be built and understood. Okay, so most of the assignments are going to be built around that. This will typically be somewhere around 20% of the final grade. So they will be graded. You are expected to take them seriously. And please do submit your assignments on time. 20% is a big chunk of your grade. It can easily make one or two grades difference if you are not careful. Okay. This is a graduate level course. There is only so much amount of sort of micro monitoring and micro managing that we can do. We expect that all of you are sincere students and you are not going to copy. Okay. Unfortunately, every year some amount of copying does happen. If we do find that copying is happening, both copier and copyee get zero. Okay, we are not interested in finding out who copied from whom. If we find such a situation, then no further questions, both people get zero. Right? Please do not let such a situation arise. Okay, do your assignments properly. It is better to submit a half-baked assignment where you have not got the full result than to try and copy somebody else's results. Okay. There are teaching assistants for the course. They will be able to help you out. So use that. There is a class forum. All of that, you know, we'll be giving you the information about. The rest of the grading is going to be two quizzes as per the regular institute schedule plus the end semester exam. This will typically be 20 plus 20 plus 40. There may be some changes to this. We may make the assignments 25% instead of 20. We'll let you know if there is any change. That will be it. It will be maybe a 5% change here or there. Okay? That will be announced later if necessary. So as far as the tools and so on, we'll let you know as we get to them. Okay? Everyone is expected to have a registration already or a login on the Moodle website for the course, right? So those of you who are new here, please take a look at this URL, courses.iitm.ac.in. You should be able to log into it using the LDAP username and password that was given to you, or hopefully you have already got it. If you have not yet already got it, you should be getting it soon from the computer center. Okay, you should be able to log into this, and all the material, the assignments, the lecture notes, any other relevant information will be put up on this website. Announcements relevant to the class will also be made through this course Moodle. Okay, which means that unless you are the email that you use on Moodle, if you put a wrong email over there, you will not get those updates. So please make sure that you check your email regularly. You are expected to check email once a day in general. Okay, announcements will be going out over email. Okay, there are teaching assistants for the course. There are a total of 6 teaching assistants, right? Their contact details will be put up on the Moodle website. But in the meantime, you know, in general, ESB 119. That's in the middle wing, in the mezzanine floor, is one place where you will find the majority of the TAs, right? So the best way is usually to send people an email and ask them when you can meet up with them if you want to get any doubts clarified. Okay? As far as I myself am concerned, my name is Nitin Chandrachudan. My office is ESB 245C. Email address is nitin@ee.ac.in. iitm.ac.in. Okay. In general, the best way to get in touch with me is by email. Okay, I usually respond at least the same day. Okay. Please do not just come and stand outside my office and say, you know, I tried waiting there for 3 days, but you are not there. I may be there, I may not be there, right? But if you send me an email, I will let you know when you can meet me, or will try and respond to your question over email itself. Okay. So that's basically it. There's just one last thing. The references for this course or reference textbooks. We are primarily using one book as more or less text for the course, which is by Westay, Harris and Banerjee. This is I think the Pearson Indian edition, so it's a low priced edition. The book is CMOS VLSI Design. Circuits and Systems Perspective. Now, I'll just need to confirm whether we are using the third edition or the fourth edition on this, right? I'll let you know about that soon, in case you are thinking of buying it. It should not matter whether which one, even if you want to go for the more updated fourth edition, it's fine. The material is more or less the same in both. The other reference book is by Rabai, Chandrakasan and Nikolic. This is Digital Integrated Circuits, a Design Perspective. The second book is relatively old. It's, I think, more than 15 years old at this point, but is a very, very, very good reference as far as fundamental concepts of the course are concerned. Okay. Apart from this, of course, there are a whole bunch of different similar books on digital integrated circuits. Pretty much all of them cover very similar material, so you can't really go wrong picking one of them. Okay. But each one of them deals with certain topics differently. Wherever there's a clash or wherever there are some confusion regarding terminology or anything else, we'll be following the first book. That's why I'm giving these as the top references. Okay. But again, for the most part, you do not necessarily need to have these books. I would strongly recommend you do get one of them because they are very good references. Okay. As far as the problems and so on are concerned, we'll be giving you the exact problem statements to actually work out. So, you know, you can work with that. All right. Any other questions? All right. We'll meet tomorrow at 9.